Good morning. So today we'll be starting polyaromatic hydrocarbons, which are also known as PAHs. Okay, polyaromatic hydrocarbons. So what are these polyaromatic hydrocarbons? Or they are also known as polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons. Okay, they are also hydrocarbons. They contain hydrogen and carbon. Okay, these compounds only contains a carbon and a hydrogen in the system. Okay, they are known as polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. Okay, the word hydrocarbon is very important. These are organic compounds, cyclic, unsaturated compounds, organic compounds containing carbon and hydrogen. They are composed of multiple aromatic rings. So they have got many aromatic rings which are fused or isolated types of aromatic ring. Okay, the rings in which electrons get delocalized. So these are polyaromatic. The simplest such example is naphthalene having the two aromatic ring, two benzene ring. When they are fused together, it is known as naphthalene. And if there are three rings come together, it is known as anthracene and phenanthracene, depending upon the mode of arrangement. It is either anthracene or phenanthracene. So what is polyaromatic system? Polyaromatic hydrocarbons are compounds which contains carbon and hydrogen. They are cyclic. They contain multiple aromatic rings. They contain multiple aromatic rings in which the electrons are delocalized. The simple example is your naphthalene, which contains two aromatic benzene ring, and the three aromatic benzene rings, examples of anthracene and phenanthracene. So now let's go into the broader classification of polynuclear hydrocarbons. So there are two examples. One is benzoid and non-benzoid. So in benzoid also there are two subclasses, that is isolated and fused. Okay, in isolated, the two aromatic rings are connected by a single bond. Okay, by a bond. So it is not connected together. They are not fused, but they are connected by a bond. So the example is biphenyl. So next example is fused. One is linear, where they are all in the same, and other one is an angular. So linear example, in the case it will be anthracene, naphthalene, whereas in case of angular, because it is not a straight, it is in an angle. That's why it is known as angular. Example is phenanthracene. Okay, phenanthracene. Okay, non-benzoid means there is not, because the basic unit does not contain a benzene ring. So here you can see it contains a 7-membered and a 5-membered ring that are fused together in case of acetylene. So this is the broad classification of polynuclear hydrocarbon. Very important. This is asked in the exam. What are polyaromatic hydrocarbons? Classify. It might come for 2 marks or a part of 10 marks questions or a part of question. Okay. So what is benzoid? Benzoid means similar to benzene structure or linkage. Okay. They have aromatic ring. So the basic thing is that they should contain a compound which is similar to that of benzene. Means it has got 6-membered ring with alternate double bonds, conjugated system. So they can be either isolated or fused. Fused means the two rings are combining together. They are fused together, means they are brought together. So example of your isolated ring is biphenyl or diphenyl, where the two aromatic benzene rings are joined by a single bond, carbon-carbon single bond. That is an example of isolated ring. Okay, now let's go for the physical property. Okay, fused example is your naphthalene and all. They come under fused or condensed ring, which will be studying in detail. So now let's go for the physical properties of polyaromatic hydrocarbons. So polyaromatic hydrocarbons are lipophilic, means it is more soluble in your organic layer. They are nonpolar molecules. They tend to persist in the environment because pHs are not very freely soluble in water. So they tend to persist in the environment because polyaromatic are not soluble. Because they are not soluble, though, they are deep inside the sea or in the soil where they are available. they are weakly volatile and dissolve weakly in water. So these are all weakly dissolved in, they are not that volatile, and also they are weakly soluble in water. Okay, all PAHs are solid at room temperature and they have high melting and boiling point. Because it is a fused system, it contains many benzene rings which is attached to it, minimum two. So as you increase the size, that is the molecular size increases, we know that your physicochemical properties increases, like melting point, boiling point increases. The movement of polyaromatic hydrocarbons in the anion depends upon the properties such how easily can dissolve in water and how easily can, so the movement, how they are transferred, how they exist in the environment depends upon how easily they dissolve and how easily they evaporate. So if you see naphthalene balls, so over a period of time they evaporate and you get the aroma of that. So which is used as an anti to remove the all moisture and as an insecticide, this naphthalene balls. So this does contain naphthalene in it. So their presence in aeron depends upon their solubility in water and how easily they evaporate in the air. So these are some of the physical properties of your polyaromatic hydrocarbons. Now let's go for the structures of fused rings. So first is the structure of naphthalene. So if you can see the structure of naphthalene, I will be showing you one by one. Okay, so naphthalene contains, one benzene ring, two benzene ring. So it contains two benzene ring inside it. It contains two benzene ring. So this is the most simplest of your polyaromatic. It is known as naphthalene. So a numbering is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now this is 4A and this is 8A. The one which is the bridging bond is always represented by the letter A from preceding with the number. So this is naphthalene. This is naphthalene. Now what is anthracene? It is an example of your linear polyaromatic system. Why it is called linear? Now you'll understand. Why it is called linear? See, if it is a straight one, so it is called as linear polyaromatic. Now this is anthracene, three carbon, okay, three benzene ring contain. Now next example is phenanthracene. So you have got just like what they have given, I'll be showing you how it is. So this is an example of phenanthracene. Is it straight? No, it is in an angle. So this is the angle. So that's why this is an example of your, angular polyhedron. So next is tetracene. So this is the main constituent in your tetracycline. You know the antibiotic tetracycline, all of them know tetracycline antibiotic, which was used, tetracycline. So this particular four membered hydrocarbon containing four aromatic ring. So this is known as tetracene, very much important ring. This is the part of your tetracycline antibiotic. This is the basic constituent of your tetracycline. And this is the basic pharmacophore of your, so 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is a linear four aromatic ring polyaromatic hydrocarbon, and it is known as tetracene. Okay. What is the next diagram? Chrysine. So this is an example of angular. So this is an example of angular polyaromatic hydrocarbon. This chrysine is an example of angular tetracycline. Okay, angular hydrocarbon.
Can go and ask. Actually, I don't have because I just come 2 years back. They don't stay over there.
Okay.
They don't. We are talking about
201.
Pandit. Yeah. So they don't stay over here.
Okay.
I don't have this number. You can just ask Dinah.
204. 204. Okay.
Yeah. Just about this.
Okay.
She might be having it. I don't have because when I was over here, he was not present.
Okay.
I have never seen him, to be frank. He knows my dad.
But okay.
I am not in touch with you.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay. So chrysine is an example of angular 4-carbon container, 4-benzene ring containing polyaromatic system. Now if you can see pyrene. See, all these things will be very important when you are writing the structure or in your phytochemistry. This all compounds play an important role in phytochemistry. Chrysine is how much? So you have got, how to remember? 2, then followed by an angular. So you get 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. So this is chrysine. So this is angular. But when you try to stack it one above another, when you try to stack it one above another, okay, that is an example of pyrene. Okay, these are some of the aromatic hydrocarbons. Very important to be named. These compounds will be coming. They will ask for 2 marks in your exam. They'll ask for 2 marks in your exam. Okay. So this is an example of your all the example of fused polyaromatic hydrocarbons. Okay. So I would like you to practice this. So let's look at the nomenclature. So if you have seen beta naphthol, alpha naphthol. So now just write the structure of naphthalene. Okay. Let's write the structure. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4. So this particular first carbon is also known as alpha, second is known as beta, third is known as alpha, third is known as beta, and fourth is known as alpha. So if they say 1 alpha naphthol or 2 nitro naphthalene, so means the nitro is at the second position. Similarly, if they say beta, they can also say 2 nitro naphthalene or beta nitro naphthalene. So if you want to say OH, if it is OH is at the first position, it is known as alpha naphthalene or 1 naphthol. If the OH is at the second position, it is known as beta naphthol or 2 naphthol. So depending upon the position of your substituent in the ring, we can either call it alpha naphthol or we can call it beta naphthol. If it is at first position, it is known as alpha, and if it is at the second position, it is known as beta naphthol, alpha and beta. So this thing is about the nomenclature. Now let's start with the first compound, that is naphthalene. Let's start with the first compound in the series of polyaromatic hydrocarbons, naphthalene. So you have seen it over there. So 2 rings, basically it contains 2 rings. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and this is 4A and 8A. Okay, so 1 and is called as alpha, 2 is called as beta, 3 is called as beta, 4th is called as alpha, 5 is called as alpha, 6 is called as beta, 7 beta, and 8 alpha. Okay, these are the positions. And the next thing is how to write the resonance structure. Very important to be, So if you can see, there can be different ways where your aromatic system can be expressed. Okay, so they can be resonating. If you see the structures, you can see first there is an alternate, then the double bond comes in between the other structure. The double bond goes to another from one benzene ring. The double bond gets shifted, your conjugated double bond shifted to another. So there is a continuous rotation of your pi electrons across the fused system. That's why they are aromatic in nature. Moreover, how much electrons they pi electrons they contain? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So if it is containing 10, means 4n plus 2 pi electrons, means when n is equal to 2, you get 10 pi electrons. So this satisfies your aromaticity. That's why your naphthalene is aromatic in nature, because they are conjugated, they are planar, they are cyclic, and they follow the 2n 4n plus 2 pi electron system. Okay, so you have to know how to write the resonating structure of your naphthalene. Okay, now let's go for the next. So later on it was found that though they are aromatic, but all the carbon-carbon double bonds were not to be same. When they did the X-ray diffraction study, they found that the bond length between C1 and C2 double bond was 1.36 angstrom, whereas that of between C2 and C3 was found to be 1.04 angstrom. So there was some discrepancy because of this structure. They found, and moreover, this was confirmed that resonance energy of naphthalene is 61 kilocalories per mole, whereas that of benzene is 36. So when we try to multiply it by 2, it should have been, so the difference between your two resonance energy is only 25, though it should have been 72, it is only 25. So since the resonating energy is less as compared to benzene, so this naphthalene is less aromatic and more reactive than that of your benzene ring. Okay, so an isolated benzene is more stable than your naphthalene. The two reasons, first of all the bond and length was found to be different. Moreover, they have got less resonance energy compared to that of your benzene. So in case of naphthalene, you know there are two benzene rings, so multiplied by 2, 36 into 2 is 72, but it was found to be 61. So when you it has got less energy compared to that resonance energy compared to that of your single benzene ring. So that's why naphthalenes are less stable and more reactive compared to that of your benzene ring. Okay, remember this point. So let us see the next thing. So it follows the aromatic, as I said, it has got 4n plus 10 pi electrons, so they are aromatic. The heat of hydrogenation was found to be minus 61 kilocalories, lower than the predicted of the resonance stabilization energy. Since benzene, as I said, has got minus 36, so when you multiply it by 2, the difference between is less than 36. So that's why your naphthalene is less aromatic, stable than that of your thing. It has got every criteria is met. Only thing is that the resonance energy is lesser than that when you compare to that of your benzene. Hello. Okay, so it follows all the criteria for aromaticity, but only one thing what was found, that they have lesser resonating energy compared to that of your benzene. So the difference was less than 36. That's why they are less stable than that of your benz. Okay. So that was the criteria. Now let's go for the next one. Now, the most important part of your this topic, synthesis of your polyaryl. This is frequently asked in your exams. Okay. These are frequently asked. The first method is you get it from your petroleum products. When you extract your petroleum extraction with copper at 680 degrees Celsius, you get your naphthalene from that. The first synthetic method is when you treat 1-butyl-3 in benzene. Okay, you treat. So this is benzene ring. So what does it contains? 1, 2, 3, 4. So there is an double bond at the third position. So that's why it is known as 1-butyl-3-enyl-benzene. So benzene is at one position. Your double bond is at the three position. That's why it is known as 1-butyl-3-enyl-benzene. So when you treat, when you heat it at red hot condition with calcium oxide, okay, you get your naphthalene. That is your first method for preparation of your naphthalene. I just want you to write simultaneously as I teach. Okay, so you take 1-butyl-3-enyl-benzene. You treat it with when you heat it in red hot condition with your calcium oxide, you get your naphthalene with liberation of your hydrogen gas. That is the first synthetic method for preparation of naphthalene. So what do you take? Bute 1, 2, 3, 4. There is a double bond at the third position, and it is attached, and the phenyl ring is at the first position. So this is the structure of your starting material, and that gives you, it undergoes fusion reaction to give your corresponding naphthalene. Now the most important method for the synthesis, which is asked for 5 marks in your exams. Individually, it can be asked for 5 marks. Okay. So what is the first step? It is Haworth synthesis. Haworth synthesis, very important. Mark triple asterisk for this particular topic. Haworth synthesis. So it's a multi-step preparation of your naphthalene. Means there are many steps in the preparation. The first step is your Friedel-Crafts alkylation with of your benzene with succinic anhydride, followed by Clemmensen's reduction, cyclization, reduction, and dehydrogenation, that is oxidation. So these are number of steps that are involved in naphthalene preparation. So let's go by one by one step, and I just want you to write simultaneously with me. Okay, so let's go for the first step. What is the first step? It is Friedel-Crafts. It is nothing but Friedel-Crafts acylation. So you treat it with succinic anhydride. This is succinic anhydride. You treat it with succinic anhydride in presence of AlCl3. Ring opening occurs. So if you can see, okay, the ring opening occurs. The ring opening occurs over here, and this carbonyl attacks, positive charge comes on this carbonyl carbon, and it undergoes an electrophilic substitution reaction on the benzene ring. So this is what you get after that. Okay, C double bond O. Okay, so this is what you get. That is the first step. First step is your Friedel-Crafts acylation. Okay. What is the next step? Once you have got this, okay, so next step is your Clemmensen's reduction. What is Clemmensen's reduction? Clemmensen's reduction, but when you treat zinc amalgam with HCl. So when you react this compound, so any carbonyl compound, if it is present in the system, this Clemmensen reduction will only reduce your carbonyl compound group, functional group. So what happens? This particular carbonyl group that gets reduced. So you get this particular. So it will only reduce your aldehyde and ketone, not your acid. Okay, remember this thing. So what do you get? You get, it gives you a gamma phenyl, alpha, beta, theta, gamma. Okay, omega, gamma. So it will give you a gamma phenyl butyric acid, gamma phenyl or 4-phenyl butyric acid. You get your 4-phenyl butyric acid. So if you can't remember alpha, beta, gamma, you can write 4-phenyl butyric acid. You get 4-phenyl butyric acid. Okay. So what do you see? This carbonyl groups, the keto group gets reduced and you get an saturated system. Okay. So that is second step is Clemmensen's reduction. Second step is Clemmensen's reduction. So this is where you get your, this is the second step of your naphthalene preparation as per Havertz. So what is the next step? Next step is your cyclization. Next step is your cyclize. This reagent, when you treat it with any concentrated acid like polyphosphoric acid or sulfuric acid, concentrated sulfuric acid, it undergoes cyclization. It undergoes cyclization and you get a carbonyl at the top, okay, to give you an alpha tetralone. You get an alpha tetralone. Link closure occurs in the third step, that is cyclization. HF, polyphosphoric acid, ester support, they can be used as an cyclizing agent. Next step is again, you are, it undergoes, so this carbonyl group is there, we have to remove that carbonyl group. So you treat it with Clemmensen's reduction, then zinc amalgam with HCl, concentrated HCl. So you get an fully saturated ring. You get a fully saturated ring. Okay, you get a fully saturated ring. See the arrow, it is on the opposite side. Don't get confused. Okay, you get a fully saturated. And the last step is oxidation with your, or dehydration with palladium carbon. When you do the oxidation with your palladium carbon, this tetralene that is formed in the previous step gets converted into your naphthalene with evolution of your carbon dioxide. So these are the steps involved in Havertz. First step is your Riddlecraft's acylation, followed by Clemmensen's reduction, then cyclization using polyphosphoric acid or any concentrated acid. Then again, the tetralone that we have got, 4-tetralone, that is reduced to tetralene. And the final step is oxidation using selenium or palladium to yield your naphthalene compound. So this is how your naphthalene is prepared using Havertz synthesis. Using Havertz synthesis, very important from your examination point of view. The reaction occurs if your R is ortho or para directing compound, NH2, methyl amino groups or OH groups. If such groups are there, they are ortho para directing group, they will be affecting. And if it is R is meta directing, then there is no reaction. So this can be, this reaction can be favored by electron withdrawing group. Okay, sorry, electron donating group, not withdrawing group. Electron withdrawing group will not favor this thing, and it will be always at the beta substitution. We get a beta substituted compound. We get a beta substituted compound in the following group. So if it is so always, if there is an amino group will be at the beta position only, OH group will be at the beta positions only, because the addition will take place para to your particular substitute. That's why we get a beta substituted product if there is an amino or nitro amino or OH group or ether or alkyl group, it will be at the beta position. So remember, you get a beta substituted product if there is a substitution in the benzene ring. Okay, now what is the next way from beta benzylidine? Okay, when you take beta benzylidine propionic acid, you get your corresponding, first is your tetralone. Okay, then which undergoes tautomerism, you get your tautomerism, this carbonyl group. If you know ketoenol tautomerism will go, you get an OH. And the last step is your removal of your water. So when you remove, it undergoes dehydration and you get a cyclized product. When you treat it with zinc, you get a cyclized product. So benzylidine 3-propionic acid, when you treat it with the concentrated sulfuric acid, it undergoes cyclization first step, followed by your ketoenol tautomerism. That when you treat it with zinc, it undergoes dehydration and you get your corresponding naphthalene. So this is the third method for preparation of your naphthalene. Okay, this is the third method. First is your cyclization, followed by ketoenol tautomerism, and then it is dehydration to give your corresponding naphthalene moiety. You do your corresponding. This is the third method for preparation of your naphthalene. And these are the overall methods which are used in the synthesis of your naphthalene. So through this method, through all these different methods, you can prepare naphthalene. So you can prepare naphthalene by three methods. And one is from your petroleum ether. So this chart shows the different ways where you can prepare naphthalene. Okay. So these are various methods for preparation of your naphthalene. So that's enough for today. Only till preparation I will do. If you have not understood anything in this, please ask me right now. Okay. First is naphthalene reduction. See the conditions. Naphthalene, when it reduced with sodium and ethanol, you get 1,4-dihydronaphthalene. So when you reduce, your 1 and 4th position gets reduced. Okay. Next, when you treat it with sodium and isoamyl alcohol, you get tetraline. That is 1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. And the same thing when you reduce with raninical, that is hydrogen gas, you get an decaline, that is decahydronaphthalene, that is decaline. Okay, so this is the reduction. So this is reduction of naphthalene. Okay, this is first. Now comes oxidation. See the conditions. So when you treat with chromium oxide along with acetic acid, you get 1,4-naphthaquinone. You get 1,4-naphthaquinone. Whereas when you treat it with ozone, zinc and water, you get thalaldehyde. You get thalaldehyde. And this, and when you treat it with oxygen and vanadium pentoxide, you get your thallic anhydride. And when you treat it with KMnO4, you get your thallic acid. You get your thallic acid. So what is the, you are very much important. Chromium oxide, you get naphthaquinone, 1,4-naphthaquinone, ozone, zinc, you get your aldehyde. In presence of oxygen and vanadium pentoxide, you get your thallic anhydride. And when you treat it with KMnO4, it gets oxidized to thallic acid. Ring opening occurs. Okay. So this is the oxidation reaction. Now let's go. What happens where addition? So when you add chlorine, okay, when you add chlorine, you get 1,4-dichloro-1,4-dihydronaphthalene. So when you add chlorine, you get 1,4-dichloro-1,4-dichloronaphthalene. And when you treat it with the excess of chlorine, you get 1,2,3,4-tetrachloro-1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. Okay, so these are the products by, so they get added. So you get 1,4-dichloro and 1,4-dihydronaphthalene when there is less amount of, when you take excess of chlorine, you get 1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. So this is addition of chlorine. Now let's go for the reaction of naphthalene, that is electrophilic substitution. So it follows Free's rule. The most stable rearrangement of a polynuclear aromatic compound is that form which has maximum number of benzoid ring. So whenever there is a maximum number of benzoid ring due to the substitution reaction, then the substitution reaction takes place at that particular position. Now let's say number of resonating structures. So according to, now you have to at which position, 1 or 2. So we have to consider number of resonating structures and aromatic sex in retained. So what is the steps involved? So let us see. The carbocation and the trans resulting from the attack at the one position is much more stable than those resulting from attack at, therefore one substitution will be. So why is the reason? So what happens when there is an attack on the first carbon? So when there is an attack on the first carbon, the number of benzoate ring is more. If you see number of in the resonating structures, the number of benzoate rings are more. Okay. Whereas when there is an attack at C2, it destroys the benzoate structure of the ring. So that's why the naphthalene undergoes electrophilic substitution reaction at the alpha position or at the C1 position, carbon 1. Because when there is an attack at the C1 carbon atom, two resonance structures with benzene. Whereas when there is an C2 attack, there is only one resonance structure with the benzene ring. That's why the most stable intermediate is C1 attack, which gives faster reaction. So electrophilic substitution reaction in case of naphthalene takes place at the alpha position, Okay. It takes place at the alpha position. Okay. So let me do again this thing. So let's go for oxidation first, reduction. So in case of reduction, what did I say? When you treat it with sodium and ethanol, you get 1,4-dihydronaphthalene. Okay, 1,4. See, at the first and the fourth position, there is an extra hydrogen. That's why it is known as 1,4-dihydronaphthalene. In case of sodium and isoamyl, you get 1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. You get 1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. You get 1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. Okay. And if you treat it with raninickel and hydrogenation, then you get an decalene. Then you get a decalene moiety. So what is the next? Oxidation. So oxidation, when you treat it with chromium oxide, you get 1,4-naphthoquinone. That is, carbonyl group is at the first and the fourth position. The carbonyl group is at the first and the fourth position. The carbonyl group is at the first and the fourth position. Okay. Now, when you do oxidation with ozone and zinc, you get thalaldehyde, means dihaldehyde you get. Thalic aldehyde, okay, means two aldehyde group is present. And the same reaction when you do it in presence of oxygen and vanadium pentoxide, you get your thalic anhydride, that is cyclized. And when you treat it with KMnO4, you get your thalic acid. So this naphthalene can be used in the preparation of your thalic acid. Okay, this is oxidation. Now comes chlorine. As I said, when you take lesser amount of chlorine, you get 1,4-dichloro-1,4-dihydronaphthalene. Okay, and the same when you do the reaction in presence of excess of chlorine, you get 1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. Why it is named so? Because there will be one hydrogen and a chlorine at the individual carbon atom. That's why it is known as 1,2,3,4-tetrachloro-1,2,3,4-tetrahydronaphthalene. Okay. Now let's go for electrophilic substitution reaction. So what is Free's law? Okay. This is important from your examination point of view. This is asked in your exam. So the most stable arrangement of a polynuclear compound is that form which has maximum number of rings in the benzoid condition. So when there is a resonating structure, when you draw the resonating structure, any substitution which gives maximum number of benzoyl structure, that means it should contain a benzene ring, that will be more stable arrangement. So now let us consider, as I said, 1 and 2 position. So you should see number of resonating structure and aromatic substituent is retained now. Okay. So in case of carbocation resulting from the attack, 1 position is more stable than the resulting attack from the, therefore 1 will be more preferred. There is substitution at 1 position. Why? Because when you attack, if you see the structure, when there is an attack at the C1 carbon, the benzoid structures are two. There are two benzoid structures. Whereas when there is an attack at the second position, there is only one benzoid structure in the resonance ring form. So that's why the most stable intermediate is your C1 attack. Electrophilic substitution takes place at the C1 position. Now let's see the example why. You have to draw the resonating structure at C1. So at the C1 position, the carbo intermediate is stabilized by the two resonating structure. So electrophilic substitution takes place at the first position. Whereas in case of your second position, you get only one resonating stable structure. That's why the electrophilic substitution takes place is preferred at the first position rather than the second position. Now let's take the example. So nitration, concentrated nitric acid, 1 nitronaphthalene and concentrated H2SO4 at 40 degrees Celsius, you get naphthalene 1 sulfonic acid. But when you heat it at high temperature, you get naphthalene 2 sulfonic acid. So at high temperature, when the steric hindrance is broken down, you get naphthalene 2 sulfonic acid. You do Friedel-Crafts, you get halogenation reaction, you get chlorine. So that was in presence of UV. When you do the reaction in presence of and Lewis acid, you get an electrophilic substitution reaction. You get 1 chloro naphthalene. It undergoes Friedel-Crafts acylation to give you an 1 acetyl naphthalene. Okay. And if you do it in carbon disulfide, you get 1. And if you do it in nitrobenzene, the reaction, you get 2 acetyl naphthalene. So 2 acetyl naphthalene means nitrobenzene means it is done at higher reaction temperature. So you get an 2 acetyl naphthalene. You get a 2 acetyl naphthalene. Okay. So this are some of the examples of electrophilic substitution reaction. Now, sulfonation. Sulfonation. The lower stability of 1S is attributed to steric interaction of the sulfonyl group. Okay? Because of the steric hindrance. So, in case of that, it will try to interact with the steric interaction. So, it will prefer the, so at high temperature, so the one isomer, the one sulfonyl naphthalene will be less stable because of its bulkiness, it will interact with the neighboring 8 hydrogen. So that will be unstable. That's why when you do it at higher temperature, you get a stable beta naphthalene sulfonic acid because of your steric interference. When you do it at beta position, there is a less interaction between your adjacent hydrogen. That's why in case of sulfonation, because of the steric interaction, the beta naphthalene structure, sulfonic acid is more formed and more stable. Okay. So now let us see the effect of substitution on the ring. So if there are active on the electrophilic substitution, so if there is an activating group, they direct the electrophile to the same ring. So if it is an activating group, that is an electron donating group, it is present. So it will prefer addition in the same group. Okay, same ring. Like electron donating group, NH2OH, alkyl or ether. Whereas deactivating group direct the substitution on the other ring. So electron withdrawing like nitro, carbonyl, carboxylic acid, cyano and sulfonic group, they will promote the reaction in the another ring, not on the same ring. So let us see what is the condition. So in case of electron donating group, it is an homonuclear attack. What do you mean by homonuclear attack? In the same ring, the electrophilic substitution reaction takes place. So when the electron donating group is at one position, the major product will be, substitution will take place at the fourth position, and minor product will be at the second position. Whereas if the electron donating group is at the second position, the major product will be at the, your electrophilic substitution will take place at the first position. Okay, so it is an homonuclear attack. So what do you mean by homonuclear attack? If there is any substitution and it is an electron donating group, then the electrophilic substitution takes place on the same ring which contains the substituent, then that is known as homonuclear attack. Now let us go for electron withdrawing group. So if there is an electron withdrawing group, okay, then the reaction, electrophilic substitution reaction takes place at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 7 and 8th position. So the substitution will take place at either 7th and 8th position. Similarly to that, when it is at the 2nd position also, it will take place at the 7th, 5th and 8th position. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 5 and 8th position. So this is where the reaction will take place. Okay. So why it is called heteronuclear? So the electrophilic substitution takes place at another ring. That's why it is known as heteronuclear attack. Okay. Now let us see some examples. So you got an beta alpha naphthol. So alpha naphthol is what? Electron donating group. So what it will do? It will favor what? 4 nitro beta naphthol. It will undergo 4 nitro beta naphthol. And minor is 2 nitro beta naphthol. Okay. If it is beta naphthol in concentrated ester, it will form 1 nitro beta naphthol. So what is the next thing? So this was an example of electron donating group. Now let us take an example of electron withdrawing group, like nitro. Nitro is an electron withdrawing group. So if there is a nitro, and if you want to do the nitration of the nitro naphthalene at first position, if there is nitro, so you'll get a major product as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 nitro, 1, 5 dinitro naphthalene, and the minor products will be 1, 8 dinitro naphthalene. So if it is at first position, now if it is at second position, you get a mixture of 5 and 6 nitro dinitro naphthalene. So these are the products. See, in case of your electron donating group, the substitution takes place and the ring itself, same ring itself. But if it is an electron withdrawing group, the substitution takes place at the adjacent ring. That's why it is called heteronuclear. And in case of electron donating, it is called homonuclear. Very important concept to be remembered. Okay. Now let's see for the uses of naphthalene. They are used in repair of moth repellents, in which role is replaced by dichlorobenzene. Okay. It is used for commercial production of phthalic anhydride, phthalic acid. It is used in making of insecticide, tanning agent. It is also used for manufacture of dyes, explosive and synthetic resin. So these are the uses of naphthalene. These are the